welcome to another edition of City Beat TV. I'm your host, Lakia Stanton, and today we have the pleasure of speaking with three gentlemen who were a part of a very significant historical period in the United States. We're going to talk about the impact that that period has had on the United States in present day, as well as the impact that it's had on their lives. We have Mr. Eugene Bryce, Richard Tyrrell, and Tony Francis in the studio today, and each of them is going to share their story as well as their current views on that period.
Now, I grew up in New York City, in Harlem, nothing but black people. So I wasn't prepared to deal with that racism. When I went to Officer Candidate School, we were taught the mission. We weren't taught about these politics and be aware of all these things that happened around us. And most of the units I served in may have had one or two black officers in a battalion. That's like 2 in 500 men, 700 yeah. men. Mm-hmm. And my experience, my first company commander was from Georgia. My second one was from Mississippi. My third one was from Alabama. My fourth one was from South Carolina. And the one that treated me the best was from Maryland.
This is Wally Terry. For more than 2 years, I was in Vietnam with black soldiers of today. When they first came to Vietnam, they were anxious to prove themselves in the most integrated war in American history, sharing the leadership, sharing the foxholes, and sharing the plastic bags.
But I would, being naive, I didn't think that people would waste so much time to ensure that I would fail.
Black soldiers who died in wars before were forgotten. Did you ever hear of black soldiers who fought the Indians for the Pilgrims, who died at Valley Forge, who turned the tide of the Battle of New Orleans, who were massacred in the Civil War, who led Teddy Roosevelt up San Juan Hill, who drew the praise of France in World War I, and who commanded tanks for George S. Patton.
You know, and it was so obvious that we were set up, because they put Tony and I together, so we'd fail together. I mean, it was a setup. It was a setup. They put us together, and they kept us together, from a platoon sergeant to the first sergeant and come to command. They don't have, that doesn't happen. But they said, they're gonna fail, they're gonna make them fail together.
Black Navy and Marine officers got together one night in Da Nang. Doctors, lawyers, helicopter pilots, tank commanders, and combat sergeants.
I best serve my country and best serve the Negro people by setting an example, because I'm not in a position to instruct. So I go out there in the bush and I do the thing that I'm most qualified to do. I can beat that bush bar none better than most. So the Negroes that work for me, they're not as qualified, but I give them that tool the good man gave me, that little bit of knowledge. I give it to them with all the energetic effort that God has given me. I didn't sit around and say what the Negro people were going to do, what we were going to overcome. I give them that bit I had accomplished myself. All the white people look back, they didn't like them, but they goddamn sure had to respect it. They had to give them that quarter. They didn't ask for none, but the man had to give it to him.
Well, we turned the clock on him. We were the best in the battalion, the best in the brigade, the best in the division. So, and they did not like that. Because we found a way to get our men to respect us, both white, black, and Hispanic, to respect us, and we respected them. And we treated them like men and like women, and we got along very well. And so they found other ways to block us, holding promotions back, passing over us for promotions. And we still fight today. I mean, we're still fighting the war today, you know, to get recognition, to get proper treatment, to get our benefits proper, get proper benefits. I mean, we all have to fight. And it's not just blacks are fighting. Our young white brothers are fighting as well to get those same skills, get those same deeds that they so well deserve.
We, black, white, Hispanic, it didn't matter. When we came home from Vietnam, each one of us individually had great feelings of alienation from our families. I mean, my grandmother used to call me her little Frankie. When I came home from Vietnam and she called me her little Frankie, this thing inside of me said, oh, if she only knew what her little Frankie has done. Mm-hmm. So there was an ingrained negative feeling about myself. And then you add on the social rejection that came to so many of us. You just felt totally out there alone on an island. And until we as veterans started to talk to each other, work together. The first veterans group in Springfield, Massachusetts was the Winchester Square Vietnam Era Vets. And all of us were involved in that. And it gave us as a group of veterans a voice together. And that's when people started to pay attention, when we stood together.
Right.